Alright, so this is the detailed composition of your CMA Part 1. CMA Part 1 has been split into 6 sections. Section A that we are going to start today, it relates to financial reporting and integrated reporting that has just been added from 2010 to January. It has 15% weightage. Planning, budgeting and forecasting, it has got 20% weightage. Performance management has 20% weightage, cost management 15, internal controls 15, and this is the new area that has been added from January 2020, technology and analytics. I'm sure all of you are aware that your paper is 4 hours long and it consists of 2 parts. The first part you have to attempt 100 MCQs and the next part you have to attempt 2 essay type questions. Most of you are probably not aware that the level of testing in the CMA exam is up to level C. What is level C? You need to know. Most of you, I'm sure you don't know. Level A is just knowledge and comprehension, understanding and knowledge. Level B, knowledge, comprehension, application and analysis. You people would be tested at level C, where you have to have all the above skills plus being able to synthesize and evaluate, give recommendations. That is the problem, that most of you are just hovering around knowledge and comprehension, to some extent application, but you need to reach this level to qualify the CMA exam, both parts. Level C is needed. Now, external financial reporting has these subtopics: balance sheet, income statement. Please remember, you will not be required to construct or draw up any financial statement on the exam in the essay type. The reason is that the essay type window is almost this wide and long, and it is impossible to draft the complete set of financial statements, even the cash flow or the balance sheet, within this small window. So that is an important point. You will be required to just calculate, like for example, cash flow statement, you might be required to just calculate the operating cash flows. Just calculate the operating cash flows. You don't have to construct the proper format of the cash flow statement, just the relevant part only. You might be required to just calculate the closing equity. You don't have to draw up the statement of changes in equity with 5 or 6 columns. So that's an important element that you must keep in mind. You will not be required to construct complete set of financial statement or even any part of it. And then this is the new thing that has been added in January 2020, integrated reporting. And these are the other areas: assets valuation, investments, valuation of liabilities, equity transactions, revenue recognition, new standard that has been issued jointly by the US GAAP. Guys, please keep your mics muted. So revenue recognition new standard would be tested. This standard has been issued jointly by IFRS, IASB and the US GAAP. Income measurement, and then just some major differences between the US GAAP and IFRS. You are not required. There are so many differences. If you draw up the list would be huge. So we just have to know about 8 to 10 basic differences. They are given in your learning outcome statement, especially those of you who have got the Wiley learning system. So they have given about 8 to 12 major differences between IFRS and US GAAP. So you don't need to know all the differences in detail, because financial reporting is a very small part of your CMA. Because if you split your entire contents in 2 parts, CMA Part 1 and 2, as you can see, financial reporting is a very small part of your entire CMA. Like CMA, if split in 2 parts, we have 6 sections in CMA Part 1 and 6 sections in CMA Part 2. Out of these 12 sections, just 1 section is external financial reporting. So very small, less than 10% of the entire, I would say just 7 or 8% of your entire CMA. So the level of account, the testing would not be as advanced as we have in CA or ACCA. Just basic knowledge of financial reporting is sufficient. So you don't have to know the complex accounting that we do in consolidation and cash flow preparation in ACC and CA. That is not the level that is expected. All right, so what is our plan? What we intend to do in the coming days? Well, we will have 2 lectures per day. What is our plan? We will be focusing on the CMA exam support package. I'm assuming that most of you would have read from some institute. Maybe most of you would be preparing yourself. I am assuming that those of you who have joined us, they have already read themselves or through some institutions. We will be focusing only on the CMA exam support package, and which contains about 372 MCQs for CMA part 1 and 374 for CMA part 2, and it also includes 30 essay types. We'll do all of them in part 1 and 20 essay types in CMA part 2. So this is the overall scope of work. I won't be discussing theory in detail. We will be doing questions, and wherever it is needed, I will explain through the questions, but our focus primarily would be on these areas. MCQs from CMA exam support package. So today's agenda is we are going to start external financial reporting. There are total 47 MCQs and a few essay type from this group of 30 essays. So we will be focusing on MCQs and related essay types from section A. Once it is over, we will move on to section B. All the MCQs in this package would be done, and the relevant essay types from this total group of essays. So that's the plan. That's the plan of action. So starting first with section A, we'll be focusing on MCQs, and wherever needed, I will explain what is needed. Now the first question . The financial statements included in the annual report to the shareholders are least useful to which of the following? There are many interested parties who are interested in the financial statement of your company. A brief list has been given. Investors, those who have bought the shares of your company. Potential investors, those who want to purchase the shares of your company. Suppliers and creditors of your company. Employees, management. These are the people who have direct interest in your company. And those who have indirect interest, they are the financial advisor and analyst. They do not have invested in your company, but they provide advice to their clients. Stock markets and exchanges, these are the regulators. They are interested in your financial statements, and the regulatory authority. So these are direct or indirect users of financial statements. The question says, which of these is least interested, or for which of these the financial statements are least useful? Stockbrokers, they have interest in the financial statement because based upon their analysis, they will give recommendation to their clients. So they are interested in your financial statements. Bankers preparing to lend you the money, they will conduct analysis of your financial statement. Based upon their analysis, they will grant you the loan or the sanction the loan. That they are interested in financial statements. Competing businesses will also compare your financial statements with their financial statements, and then they will make the comparison who is performing better. And finally, managers in charge of operating activities. These are the managers of your company, and they are in charge of operating activities, production, sales, marketing. Yes, they are employees, but amongst these four, they are the one who are least interested, or financial statement are least useful for them. They have interest, no doubt, but for them, financial statements are least useful. Guys, please. So managers in charge of operating activities, they will be the one least interested in the financial statement, or they will have the financial statement will be least useful for them. It's not that they are totally disinterested. It's that their utility, financial statements utility for them is the least comparatively with option A, B, C. Moving on, when a fixed asset is sold for less than the book value, let's say the asset has been sold for $7,000, whereas its net book value was $10,000. We received $7,000 cash, which would increase our current assets. And the asset that has a net book value of $10,000 has been disposed. Which of the following will decrease? Since we are receiving cash for the disposal of the asset, current assets will go up, this is going to witness an increase. Total current assets will increase. Current ratio, we know current ratio, those of you who have studied part 2, current ratio is the ratio of current assets upon current liabilities. Since your current assets are increasing by $7,000, so current ratio would go up as well. Last D, the asset has been disposed for $7,000. That's an increase in cash. It will increase the working capital as well. What will decrease? Net profit. Why? Because we have disposed of an asset for $7,000 which had a book value of $10,000. It means there has been a loss on disposal. So this loss on disposal will result in a reduction of net profit. So that makes C to be the correct option, and C it is. I will try to make sure wherever some knowledge, background knowledge is needed, essential, I will surely give it. On July 15th, a company entered into a 3-month agreement to rent a machine to our company. We needed this machine for making some special order. So on July 15th, a company entered into a 3-month agreement to rent a machine to us that we need to complete a special order. The machine would be delivered on August 1st. And the rental payments are due on the first day of each rental month. We will receive machine on 1st of August. We will give the first rental on 1st of August, coming month. We have neither received machine, nor are we required to make any payment now. So the effect of these events would have on company's July 31st financial statements would be. It will cause no change in assets because you are just taking it on rent. And you haven't made any payment yet. The first payment that you will make will be on 1st of August. So no payment of cash has been made, no change in assets. There is no liability because only liability will become due once we receive the asset on 1st of August. So there won't be any transaction for this. No change in assets, no change in liability, and no expense can yet be incurred because we haven't yet received the asset. Amount is not due as yet unless we receive the facility. It means A is the right answer. Cash has not yet been paid. No expense has yet been incurred because we haven't yet received the machine. So no transaction can be recorded at this point in time. Next, all of the following are limitations to the information provided on the statement of financial position. When it's a statement of financial position, that is the balance sheet. All of the following are limitations to the information provided on the balance sheet, except moving in the reverse order. Lack of current valuation for most assets and liabilities. I'm sure you would have read your theory from Gleim, Wiley or Hawk. In the US, under the US GAAP, assets are to be reported at their original historical cost less any accumulated depreciation or impairment. Assets, long-lived assets, cannot be revalued under the US GAAP. That is the limitation of balance sheet. That balance sheet in the US GAAP lack the current of valuation for most assets and liabilities. This is a limitation. Assets would be reported at their original historical cost, and it's a limitation. C, omission of items that are of financial value to the business, such as worth of employees. Competent, confident employee is an asset, but we cannot disclose this asset on the face of balance sheet. It's a limitation also. No doubt it's an asset. Having competent workforce is an asset, but we cannot report it on the face of balance sheet. It's a limitation of balance sheet as well. But something new has happened over the last 10 years. Integrated reporting requires you to disclose the competence of your employees. I'm sure you would have read the theory. Integrated reporting requires the human capital, intellectual capital to be disclosed on the financial reports. B. Judgments and estimates used regarding the collectability, saleability and longevity of assets. That's also a limitation because we use judgments. We use judgments in collectability, saleability and longevity of assets. So whenever you're using judgments, that would undermine the usefulness of financial statement. It's a limitation as well. Last one. The quality of earnings reported for the enterprise. A relates to the income statement because the quality of earnings are disclosed. Earnings, in other words, they are disclosed in income statement. So BCD, these are the limitations of balance sheet. That's what we are discussing. But the quality of earnings, it is reported on income statement, and that's not the subject we are discussing. So BCD are the limitations of statement of financial position. A is totally beyond the scope of this question because A is referring us towards income statement, and that's the reason A is the right answer. The quality of earnings reported for the enterprise cannot be determined from the income statement, even though net income is reported in the statement of changes in equity, but for earnings quality, you have to see the income statements. So that means A is the right answer. Next, a statement of financial position balance sheet provides a basis for all of the following except 1. Computing the rates of returns. Let us see them one by one. Rates of returns, first of all, returns are reported on the income statement. So having just a balance sheet will not help you determine the return. Return is mentioned or disclosed on the statement of comprehensive income statement. So that's not a possibility. Evaluating capital structure. From one aspect, we can see, rates of return, when we calculate the rate of return, that is return on assets or return on equity, it's net income upon assets. From this side, if you just see, both of these can be extracted from the balance sheet. Assets are from the balance sheet, and the net income that is added to the statement of changes in equity. Statement of changes in equity. So net income is also reported there. So we can extract these two things. Other than the quality of earnings, the net income can be seen from the statement of change in equity. So what's the question? A statement of financial position provides a basis for all of the following except. So it means, yes, A can be calculated. Computing the rates of return. Using the net income and assets, that makes A can be calculated from the balance sheet. Evaluating the capital structure. Capital structure means the different sources of financing that we have used for our business. What is the composition of those different sources of finance? How much debt or, let me plug in the charger. So we can evaluate the capital structure from balance sheet. Different sources of finances, they are reported on the balance sheet. So the capital structure, whether we are using 60% equity and 40% debt, or do we have 90% equity or 10% debt. So capital structure can be evaluated from the balance sheet. It's a correct statement. Assessing the liquidity and financial flexibility. Liquidity, current ratio, quick ratio, current assets. Current liabilities, their relative proportion, this can be seen from the balance sheet. Now, what about D? Determining the profitability and assessing the past performance. This is exclusively something that we can extract from income statement. There was a little ambiguity. Computing rates of return, balance sheet can be used to compute the rate of returns because assets are reported in balance sheet, equity is reported in balance sheet. Net income is reported as a part of statement of changes in equity. So A is possible from balance sheet, B, C, but determining profitability and past performance, this is something that you can evaluate using income statement, statement of comprehensive income. So that makes D to be the correct option, and D it is. An income statement could be used by external investors. For all of the fallings except, mind the word, this except totally reverses the requirement in a question. Moving in the reverse order. Predict the company's future revenues. Income statement will help him to predict the future revenue. There is a trend in sales. trends in profitability and gross margins. So he can use income statements to predict the future earnings. Yes, he can. Assess the risk the company's achieving future profitability. Assess the risk of the company's achieving. To what extent will the business be able to achieve required earnings? The past patterns of returns, the gross profits and net profit margins, again, similar to D, it can be assessed from income statement. Compare the company's results to those of its competitors. Yes, using income statement, you can compare your margins with a competitor. Correct. Analyze the company's performance compared to budget. This is interesting. We are talking about an external investor. He will have access to our financial statements, income statement, balance sheet, but he doesn't have access to our budget. He cannot compare our performance with our own budgets because budget is something internal to an organization. It is not available to any external investor. So that is not possible. This is not possible. BCD is possible, but A, access to the budgets of the organization, that is not publicly available. So that's why A is something that is not available for an external investor. Question number 7, the financial statement that provides a summary of firm's operations for a period. Summary of operations. Statement of retained earning, it shows the changes in retained earning over the period. This is not related to your operations. C, statement of shareholders' equity. There are different components of equity we will see in the later questions. Equity doesn't contain the results of operation. Statement of financial position, it contains your assets, liabilities, and components of equity. Incorrect. Results of operations mean income statement. That makes A to be the correct option. Moving on to the next question. Now we are talking. Now this is something, a bigger question requiring computations. Bertram Company had the balance of $100,000 in the retained earnings at the beginning of the year and $125,000 at the end of the year. This is the opening balance in the retained earning. This is the closing balance. Net income for this period was $40,000. Opening balance of retained earning, closing balance of retained earning, net income $40,000. Bertram's statement of financial position indicated that dividends payable had decreased by $5,000 throughout the year. Liability, dividend payable is a liability. So there has been a decrease in liability of $5,000 during the year, despite the fact that both cash dividends and the stock dividends were declared. Right? The amount of stock dividend was $8,000. When preparing its statement of cash flows for the year, Bertram should show cash paid for dividends as. For doing a question like this, when we have multiple items given, it is always advisable to construct the relevant account. What is the relevant account? I need to construct two accounts. First is the retained earning. I'm sure most of you are professional accountants and you know what a T account means. Where do we put the opening balances? Where do we put the closing balances? And how do we find the missing figures? You may have your own smart way of doing and finding the unknown numbers, but being a conventional accountant, I would always recommend to construct a T account, plug in the unknown numbers, the known numbers, and you will get the unknown ones. So you will construct the retained earnings accounts and the dividend payable. The good thing is that you won't make mistakes using this method, dividends payable. The opening balance of retained earning is a credit balance, $100,000, right? As a closing balance of $125,000, agree. Net income for this period is $40,000. It is credited as in retained earning. I'm sure you know retained earnings at the end of the net income at the end of the year is transferred to retained earnings. So you will see it on the credit side. This is the net income for the period. Any dividend, whether cash dividend, property dividend, stock dividend, it is paid out of retained earnings. Every dividend is paid out of retained earnings. We have two sets of dividends. One is cash dividend, we don't know yet, and the other is the stock dividend. Every dividend, whatever dividend you have studied in your CMA Part 1, would be paid out of your retained earnings, even if it's liquidation dividend. So the cash dividend, we are not yet sure. What we know for sure that the stock dividend was $8,000. Since there is nothing else, we can balance off the account. The difference on this side would represent the cash dividend, which hasn't yet been paid. Because when you declare the dividend, the entry that you post is you debit your retained earning and you credit your dividends payable. This is the entry I'm talking about. Retained earning is being debited by the amount of dividend payable. So if you total the both sides, here you have 140 and here you have 133. The difference is $7,000. This is the dividend payable. Debit retained earnings, $7,000. Credit dividends payable. This dividend payable will be credited right here in the dividend payable account. Unfortunately, I do not have the opening balance of dividend payable. I don't have the closing balance of dividend payable. He says that the amount of here, balance sheet says or indicates that the dividend payable had decreased by 5,000. Dividend payable has decreased by 5,000. I do not have the opening balance of the dividend payable. What I do know that whatever the balance was, it has decreased by 5,000. Now what I will do? I can assume any number I want, any number. Let's say I take 20,000 for example, any number. This was the opening balance of dividend payable. Opening balance of dividend payable is 20,000. And it has fallen by 5,000. It means the closing balance will have to be 15,000. No matter what you take as an opening balance, the closing would be 5,000 lower. That's the key point. It will help you find out how much dividend has been paid. The balancing figure on the debit side would represent the dividend payment. How? When the dividend liability is settled, the entry that we pass is the debit dividend payable account and credit cash or bank. This is what we are going to see, how much dividend has been paid. So you can add 20 plus 7, 27 out of this. You deduct 15. The difference is $12,000. This is the dividend that has been paid in cash. Right? So you can find unknown numbers by constructing this account, plugging in the given values. Unknowns can be found out. I have just used the technical, traditional approach of solving question like this. So $12,000 is the dividend paid during the period. $12,000 it is. Next. All of the following are the elements of income statement except expense is an element of income statement. Gains and losses are reported in income statement. Revenue is reported. Shareholders' equity, it is reported on statement of financial positions, a part of balance sheet. That makes B to be the correct option and B it is. Next, the statement of shareholders' equity is what? This is the statement of shareholders' equity. It has opening balance. Equity is not a single account. Equity exists in different components. Statement of changes in equity shows different components of your equity. Retained earning is your equity. Accumulated other comprehensive income is equity. This is the opening balance. Common stock is a part of equity. Additional paid in capital, which is called share premium in our part of the world, in India and Pakistan, share premium. It is called additional paid in capital in the US under the US GAAP. And treasury stock, these are the shares of our own company which we have purchased from the market. All these are components of equity. I'm sure you're all aware of what these terms are. Other comprehensive income, it contains certain, the balance of certain transactions. Gain and loss on fair value hedge. Then we have pension adjustment, some foreign currency translation gain and loss, and gain and loss on available for sale security. So there are certain items that represent gain and loss, but the gains and loss are so distinct that they cannot be reported on the income statement. So they are routed to your statement of change in equity through other comprehensive income. I'm sure everybody of you have, most of you would have read it. So these are the opening balances of your equity. These are the certain transactions that have taken place over the period. Net income is added to retained earning. Other comprehensive income changes is reported here. Common stock issued together with the share premium and any dividends paid or any additional shares acquired. So we had the opening balances of these equity components. There are certain changes that have taken place over the year and these are the closing balances of our equity. So in other words, this is the opening equity, total equity, and this is the closing equity. So what this statement is showing, it is showing all the adjustments in opening and closing balances of equity. In other words, it's a reconciliation of different components of equity over the period. So what's a statement of changes in equity? That's the question. A statement of changes in equity shows a reconciliation of the beginning balance of the state of different equity accounts and the ending balances of different equity accounts. It's a reconciliation. What has happened over the period? What are the changes in different components of equity? This is what the statement of changes in equity is all about. I'm sure you would have gone through this topic in detail. A is the right answer. It's a reconciliation between the opening and closing balances of equity. Which of the following items should be identified on the cash flow statement prepared under using the indirect method? We have two methods to prepare cash flow. I'm sure you would have gone through your textbooks. This is how an indirect method looks like. In indirect method, we start off with the net income amount, accrual-based net income as per GAAP. We make certain adjustments. Adjustments for working capital changes like your receivables, inventories, and payables. They can, in some cases, be added. Sometimes we have to deduct them. We'll discuss in the later. Non-cash expenses are to be reversed. Depreciation is a non-cash expense to be added back to net income. Amortization of bond discount is to be added back. If there is any loss on disposal, it's a non-cash loss. It is to be added back. And conversely speaking, any amortization of bond premium is deducted. Any gain on sale of plant asset is deducted, like loss is added. Gain on disposal is deducted. Amortization of bond discount is added. Amortization of bond premium is deducted. Loss on equity based invested is added. Non-cash loss, non-cash income is deducted. So this is called the indirect method, where we start off with the net income. We make certain adjustments. This format can be made available to you in the WhatsApp group. We make certain adjustments and we end up with the cash flow from operating activities. That's the indirect method. Now, which of the following items could be identified on the cash flow statement prepared using the indirect method, where we start off with the net income number, the payment of interest expense. We start off with the net income from which interest, most of it, interest expense is an income statement item. It's not the interest paid. There is a difference between interest expense and interest paid. Interest expense is reported on income statement, not on cash flow. Yes, interest paid has already been deducted from net income. And if there is any accrual, we will see it adjusted in working capital. A change in unrealized holding gains and loss. Unrealized holding gains and loss are non-cash gains and losses. They are not reported on cash flow statement. A settlement of a lawsuit that was previously accrued. Settlement of lawsuit would result in a charge for the company and it would be reported on the income statement. And net income is calculated after that. What we do in indirect method, we start off with net income and add this amount, depreciation, which is a non-cash expense, it is added in the net income and certain other adjustments are made, and then we get our operating cash flows. We will do many questions related to cash flow because this is the topic where you should expect at least 3 to 4 MCQs. 3 to 4 MCQs you will see on your exam will come from cash flow statement. Even on essay type, you will not be required to draft any balance sheet or income statement or cash flow. Yes, you might be required to calculate the cash flow from financing activities, calculate the total current assets, right? So just components which you can just give in a paragraph. No tabulation, no columns, no construction of proper accounting statements. That is not possible in the exams. So it means depreciation is something that is added in indirect method to arrive at the cash flows. Here we go. Depreciation expense is added in net income to arrive at the cash flow provided by operations. Next. So, this is the right answer. Depreciation is a non-cash expense and added. Now, here we go. Consider the following financial data for a company that is preparing its cash flow statement. Amortization expense, and it is silent whether it is a discount amortization or premium amortization, just amortization. Cash dividends paid to common shareholders, net income, work in process inventory increase over the period, and gain on sale of equipment. 5 items are given. We have to use these and to determine our cash flow from operating activities using indirect method. Cash flow from operating activities using indirect method. In indirect method, we start off with the net income. We start off with the net income. Net income here is 1.5 million. Since the question is silent whether this amortization is related to bond discount or bond premium, we can only go with assumption. Most of the bonds are issued at discount. It's mostly discount amortization. So what we are going to do, we are going to reverse the effect of this amortization. We will simply add it back. 150. Done. Added back. Cash dividend paid, it is not an operating cash outflow. Remember, in the US GAAP, the financial statement preparation in the US, cash dividend paid is shown as a financing outflow. It's not an operating outflow. Net income has already been considered. Amortization expense has been added back, reversed. Work in process inventory increase over the period. Whenever there is an increase in inventory, whether work in process or finished goods or the raw material, increase in your inventory basically means it's an outflow. Increase in your account receivable effectively represents an outflow. So since work in process inventory has gone up, representing an outflow, so we will deduct this amount. And as we have just seen, the gain on sale of equipment, loss is added, gain will have to be subtracted. So the gain on disposal, 50,000, must be deducted. And most of you, I think, have given the answer. You say B. Some of you are saying C. It's B, gentlemen. It's B. 1.3 million. If you calculate, it's 1,300,000. So remember, the cash dividend paid is shown as a financing outflow. So we get B to be the correct option, and B it is. Moving on, next. Yes, that's an important point too. Dividends paid to company shareholders would be shown on the statement of cash flows as what? That's something that you need to know. There is a difference between IFRS and US GAAP reporting related to these four items. Interest paid. In the IFRS, you can either show it as an operating or financing. But in the US GAAP, it is reported as operating. Interest received is reported as operating. Forget about IFRS. We are doing US GAAP. CMA is an American qualification. So focus is on the US GAAP. When the question is silent, you have to use the US GAAP approach. Dividend paid, it is considered as a financing outflow in the US GAAP. And dividend received, if you have made investment in some company and received dividend, it is considered an operating inflow. So the point we are interested in, dividends paid to the company's shareholders would be shown on the statement of cash flows as financing outflow, cash flows from financing activities. So that makes D to be the correct option. Next, all of the following are classification on the statement of cash flows, except cash flows are separated by three activities. There are three categories of cash flows: operating cash flows, investing, and financing. Operating, investing, and financing. There is no classification as equity activities. Totally a ridiculous term. That's why B is the right answer. The purchase of fixed assets should be accounted for on the statement of cash flows as what? First of all, operating cash flows relate to your income statement, revenues and expenses. Investing cash flows, they relate to investments in securities and purchase and sale of non-current assets. Financing activities involve issuance of shares, redemption of shares, issuance of bonds, redemption of bonds, and payments of dividends. It's in financing activities. Since we are talking about a fixed asset, acquisition of non-current assets, it is reported as a part of investing activity, so that makes B to be the correct option, and B it is. Next. A statement of cash flows prepared using the indirect method would have cash activities listed in which of the following orders? The order conventionally followed. First, we draw up the operating activities category, then investing, and finally financing. That's the flow that we have been conventionally following. So it's operating, investing, and financing, so that it makes D to be the correct option. Kelly Company acquired land by assuming a mortgage for the full acquisition cost. We acquired land. Let's say the valuation of land. Let's say the land valuation is $1 million. We acquired land, we debited the land, we didn't pay any cash. Kelly Company acquired land by assuming a mortgage for the full acquisition. You didn't pay even a single penny or a dollar. You acquired land through a loan, through a mortgage. Mortgage is a long-term loan on property, $1 million. It did not result in any cash outflow. So we cannot report it within the body of cash flow statement. This transaction should be disclosed on which category of the statement of cash flows. Most of you might click or select investing activities because land is being acquired. You would be doing it incorrectly. No cash on the body of cash flows. We only show the cash flows, actual cash flows from financing, investing, and operating. There is no cash involvement. Land has been acquired through mortgage. No cash is changing hands. So we have some help for you guys here. The final section of statement of cash flows consists of investing and financing items that affect reported assets and liabilities, but that have no effect on cash. Just like this, it didn't have any cash effect. What kind of transactions results in no cash impact like this? Conversion of debt to equity, no cash is changed. Assets obtained by assuming liabilities, just like this case. We acquired land through mortgage or entering into a lease agreement. Capital assets received as gifts. Exchange of non-cash assets or liabilities for another. All these transactions involve no cash. However, they are changing, affecting our assets and liabilities. We cannot show them within the body of cash flows. So where do we report them? Since these items cannot be incorporated into the body of the statement because they result in no cash flows, they are disclosed in the separate section as shown below. Summary of non-cash investing and financing activities just in verbal form. No computation is needed. So what would be the right option here? This transaction should be disclosed to where in non-cash financing and investing activity as a note or as a footnote to the statement of cash flows. That makes D to be the correct option. Which of the following should be classified as operating activity on the statement of cash flows? Operating activity. A decrease moving in the reverse order so you get the better understanding of all options. Remember, whenever you're practicing whichever software, you should try to read every option and convince yourself why a right answer is right and why a wrong option is wrong. You need to convince yourself. That's very essential. The prepayment of cash dividends from the money arising from current operations. We are talking about operating cash flows, gentlemen. Operating cash flows. Payment of cash dividend, it is not an operating cash flow. It's a financing outflow. The purchase of additional equipment needed for the current production. Purchase of equipment, it's an investing outflow, I negative. An increase in cash resulting from the issuance of previously authorized common stock. You have issued more shares. Issuance of shares results in inflow, but it's a financing inflow. Issuance of shares, it's a financing inflow. Then finally, what we are left with, BCD, they do not represent operating cash flows. Then we are left with option A only, a decrease in accounts payable during the year. And we've just seen that any increase or decrease in accounts payable, inventories, account receivables, they are shown as a part or an adjustment in the operating segment of your cash flows. So that makes A to be the correct option. Changes in current assets and current liabilities, that they're presented as a part of operating activities. When using the statement of cash flows to evaluate company's continuing solvency, operating cash flows, gentlemen, please keep your mics muted. It is resulting in distortion. When using the statement of cash flows to evaluate a company's continuing solvency, the most important factor to consider is the cash balance at the end of the period. We want to evaluate the company's continuing solvency. We have three types of cash flows: cash flow from operations, cash flow from investing, cash flows from financing activities. Continuing solvency would be determined or would be dependent upon the ability of the business to generate cash flows regularly. Investing cash flows are not regular. Financing cash flows again are not regular. They are not recursive, recurrent. The cash flows that are repetitive, that determine the company's continuing solvency, are the operating cash flows. So as a banker, I would be most interested in the operating cash flows of the company, because these are the cash flows that will help me determine or evaluate the company's continuing solvency. So that makes B to be the correct option. Next. So that makes B to be the correct option. Moving on. The most commonly used method for calculating and reporting company's net cash flows from operating activities on the income statement, or on the statement of cash flows, most frequently, most of you are professional accountants, and I'm sure you would have used indirect method all the time. That's the method that is most frequently used. Even in my professional career, I've always used indirect method. It's convenient, it's widely used. B is the right answer. The presentation of major classes of operating cash receipts, such as receipts from customers, less the major classes of operating cash disbursements, such as cash paid for the merchandise, cash paid to employees. It is called direct method. Cash receipts from your customers, cash received from sale of trading securities, interest earned, dividends received, etc. All these are operating cash inflows, and all these are the operating cash outflows. This method, gentlemen, ladies, is called the direct method, where we have the categories of different cash receipts and payments. That the question is all about. A presentation of major classes of operating cash receipts and disbursements, it is best described as direct method. It's a direct method of calculating net cash provided or used by operating activities. So major classes of cash inflows and outflows, taking these, adding up the result to find out the either the cash is provided by these activities or it has been used up. Either the cash would be provided if it is positive, or it could be negative if it has been used up. So this method is called the direct method. Very rarely used, very rarely tested on your exam. Most of the question, or all of the questions that you would be tested on exam, is from the indirect method. That's why A, direct method, is the right answer. Next, which of the following would result in a decrease to cash flows in indirect method of preparing statement of cash flows? Which of these is a deduction? Amortization is reverse, it is added. If it's a premium amortization, then it is deducted. Amortization is an added, discount amortization. We want to see something that is being deducted. Proceeds from the issuance of common stock. When common stocks are issued, we receive money. It's a financing inflow. Decrease in inventory over the period. When inventories are decreased over the period, it means they have been sold out. that would result in increase in cash flow, they are added. We are looking for something that's a deduction. Look at this. Decrease in income taxes payable. Income taxes payable will decrease when you pay out your liabilities. When you pay out your liability, that represents a cash outflow. It's a cash outflow in operation. So payment of taxes payable, if there is a reduction in taxes payable, it's basically an outflow. So that will make B to be the correct option, and B it is. Next, the information reported in the statement of cash flows should help investors. Yes, it does. Creditors, yes, and other to assess all of the following except. Mind it, the question like these, where you get the term except, it will totally twist the question altogether. So you have to be very careful when you're doing questions like these, which end with an except. Again, the information reported in the statement of cash flows should help investors, creditors, others to assess all of the following except. Cash flow statement helps us to assess the company's ability to pay dividends and meet obligations. Totally agree. I totally agree with this. True. B. Company's ability to generate future cash flows. We can see this from operating cash flows. It's true. C. Management's with respect to the efficient and profitable use of firm's resources. If you want to see how efficiently the resources have been used, cash flow won't help you. For that, you have to see the statement of comprehensive income or income statement to see the results of operations. Cash flow is not the right statement for that. And finally, cash and non-cash investing and financing transactions during the period. This can be seen from the cash flows, because cash, operating cash flows, investing cash flows, and financing cash flows would be reported. And the non-cash investing and financing, they are also reported as a part of cash flow statement. The transactions that change your assets, change your liabilities, but they do not affect the cash flows, they are reported within the cash flows, with the cash flows. So amongst all, C is the statement that is not right. C it is. Next, here we go. Larry Mitchell's Bailey Company's controller is gathering data for the statement of cash flows for the most recent year. Mitchell is planning to use the indirect method to prepare this statement and has made the following list of cash inflows for the period. The correct amount to be shown as net cash provided by operating activities. Since you are using the indirect method, you will start with net income. That's the starting point. Then, securities purchased for investment purposes with an original cost of 100,000 sold for 125. Purchase of securities, it's an investing outflow. You would have made an investing outflow. Now you're selling it, it's an investing inflow. Investing outflow, inflow, they are not part of your operating activities. Proceeds from the issuance of additional company stock, you have sold some additional shares in the company, and those shares have brought in $10,000. This is because of the financing inflow. So the only item that you should consider, yes, Yasir, you're right, it's net income only. No such item amongst these can be considered. So it means the only item that will be considered in determining operating cash flows is net income. So that makes B or A to be the correct option. And A it should be. A it is. See? Next. During the year, Deltek Incorporated acquired a long-term productive asset for $5,000. Long-term productive asset, that means it's an investing outflow of $5,000. And also borrowed $10,000 from a local bank. Acquiring loans, issuing bonds, issuing shares, they are all financing inflows. So it's a financing inflow. $10,000 is a financing inflow and $5,000 is an investing outflow. So then which of these is the correct statement? Outflow of investing activities $5,000, totally agree. And inflows from financial activities or financing activities $10,000. Perfectly Right, that makes A to be the correct option, and A it is. Next. Atwater Company has recorded the following payments for the current period. What we are required to do, the amount to be shown in investing activities. Mind the word. Investing activities sections of the cash flows. Investment. Purchase of Trillium stock. Trillium, we are Atwater Company. We are purchasing some other company's shares. Trillium stock. It's an investing outflow. It's an investing outflow. Dividends paid to Atwater's shareholders, it's a financing outflow. Remember, we have just discussed that the payment of dividend is considered as a financing outflow. Then, repurchase of Atwater's company stock. You have purchased your own stock. Buying your own stock, for whatever reason, maybe giving it as dividends in the future, or you just want to reduce the number of shares outstanding to protect yourself against a hostile takeover, whatever the purpose is, they are treasury stocks. So when you're buying these shares from the market, it's considered as a financing outflow. Since we are just interested in the investing activities, so this is an investment outflow. That's A. Most of you are correct. A is the right answer, and A it is. Next. Carlson Company, the following payments recorded for the current year. The total amount of the above items to be shown in the operating activities. Dividends paid to the Carlson shareholders, we have just agreed in the US GAAP, it is considered as a financing outflow. Interest paid on the bank loan, it is considered as an operating outflow. Purchase of equipment, it's an investment outflow. What exactly are we looking for? Operating outflow is just 250, so that will make B to be the correct option, and B it is. Next. Barber's Company has recorded the following payment for the current period. Interest paid. Interest paid, it's considered as an operating outflow. Interest paid is an operating outflow. Operating outflow. This one. Dividends paid to Barber shareholders, it's a financing outflow. Dividend payment is considered as a financing outflow. Repurchase of our company's own stock, treasury stock, it's a financing outflow. So what would be the total of financing outflows? It's 600,000. That's C. That makes C to be the correct option. And C it is. Next. Now we're talking. Christina cash flows from financing activities. Financing. Let us see these all one by one. Net income is considered as a part of operating cash flows and it's added. Increase in account receivable. Gentlemen, I need full attention. Increase in accounts receivable means you didn't collect money from your customer. It's an outflow. Operating outflow. Decrease in inventory over the period resulted in sale of inventory, it would result in cash inflow, operating inflow. Increase in accounts payable. You delayed the payment. And when you delay the payment, effectively it's a cash inflow. So if there is an increase in accounts payable over the period, effectively it is representing an operating inflow. Depreciation expense, since it's a non-cash expense, it has to be added back. Where? Operating. Cash received from the issuance of common stock. You issued common stock. You received money, it's a financing inflow. Cash paid for the dividends, it's a financing outflow. Cash paid for the acquisition of land, it's an investing outflow. Finally, what do we get? These two, and if you net them off, 800 plus, 80 negative, it's 720. B is the right answer, and B it is. Here we go. That's more like it. It's a good question. An accountant with NASHO or NASBO Enterprises has gathered the following information in order to prepare the statement of cash flows for the current year. I'm sure most of you know about the composition of your paper. Those you do not know, those of you who don't know, let me tell you what my experience tells me and what you will see once you go and write the exam. Out of the 100 MCQs, 25 MCQs are easier, just like most of the questions we have done. 50 to 60 questions would be average, neither too difficult nor too easy. Neither too difficult nor too easy. And there will be 10 to 15 questions, but not more. Some of my students have just faced maybe 3 to 4 such questions, and some have assessed all 12 to maybe 15 maximum. They will be really tough, and they will challenge your understanding about yourself, how well you have read. So paper is more or less balanced. You can see 25% very easy, 50 to 60 average, not difficult, not easy, and these would be the challenging ones. Right? All right. So this is an average question. I won't say it's too easy. I won't say it's too difficult. It's an average question. So expect 50 to 60 questions like these in theory and as well as in computations. So the net income is 456,900. We are preparing data for the cash flow statement. It includes deduction of 45,600 for depreciation. Of course, when we calculate net income, we have to deduct depreciation. What we need to do, we need to add back depreciation in order to determine the cash flow from operations. The company issued $300,000 of dividends this year. It's a financing outflow, and purchased one new building for $275,000. It's an investing outflow. The balance sheet from, yes, you can say it's level B. Level C is something that requires synthesis and evaluation, and that's where we are tested. Overall, overall, you should prepare yourself for level C. Don't focus on easy question or average. Prepare yourself well. It's a challenging certification requiring some real serious effort. You need 72% score to get through. 72% out of 100, 360 points out of 500. It's not a mean task by any standard. It's a challenge, of course. All right, so we have net income, we have depreciation, we have the dividend payment, financing outflow, we have investment outflow. What we are required to find out, operating cash inflows. Let's start first with the net income, that is 456,900. To this, first we will add non-cash expenses like depreciation, like loss on disposal, like bond discount amortization. They are reversed, they are added back. So 45,600 is the reversal of depreciation. Now we have to see these three things one by one. Your account receivables, they have decreased over the period. The decrease in account receivable represents an inflow. Represents an inflow. All right, so account receivables have decreased over the period. The decrease in account receivable effectively results in an inflow, 45,300. And it was 56,860 a year ago. So this basically reflects an inflow. We will add this number, 11,560. Accounts payable, they have decreased as well. Decrease in accounts payable effectively represents an outflow. You have settled your liability. So reduction in current liability is an outflow. And this reduction has been 2,155. And finally, inventory has increased over the period. Increase in inventory effectively represents an outflow. Increase means you have bought new inventory. It would have resulted in outflow of cash. So this represents negative 7,620. If you add them up all, 456,900 plus 45,600 plus 11,560 minus 2,155 minus 7,620 will give you a number that doesn't match. Incorrect total, if you add them up again, it will be a positive number because you have major numbers that are positive. So 504,285. So 504-285, this is the cash generated by operating activities or cash provided by operating activities. That makes C to be the correct option, and C it is. All right, just the last question for today, because how many can we do this? Gentlemen, as you can see now, our plan of action is that you people would be studying on your own. Theory is on you. Book, whatever book you're using, I don't specifically endorse which book, Gleim, Hawk or Wiley. My job is to do the essays and MCQs. Just the area that you people find difficulty in, questions, MCQs and essays. And of course, when you do the questions, you will get many things sorted out. That's how we'll move along. Next question. For the year just ended, Doran Electronics had the following results. Net income is there, fine. Depreciation expenses are non-cash expense to be added. Increase in accounts payable. If accounts payable balance goes up, it means we have delayed the payment. Delaying the payment effectively represents an inflow. Increase in account receivables mean you did not collect. When you do not collect, it's effectively an outflow. Increase in a deferred income tax liability. You didn't settle your liability. There has been increase in liability. Increase in liability effectively represents an inflow. Simply add them up and you should get your right answer. 920, 11, 110, 45, less 73 plus 16 gives you 1018. That makes C to be the correct option, and C it is. Here we go. 3 years ago, James Company purchased stock in Zebra Incorporated at a cost of $100,000. That's the acquisition cost. This stock was sold for $150 during the current year. The results of this transaction should be shown in investing activities in the statement of cash flows for what amount? Investing activities will report the net cash that we have received. Since we have received $150,000 for the disposal of these investments, we will report this $150,000. Any gain or loss, that is shown as an adjustment in operating cash flows. If you remember, the gain on disposal is deducted from net income and loss on disposal is added. Likewise, since we are discussing investing activities, in investing activities, we report the total cash received or total cash paid. Since we received $150,000, we report $150,000 in investing activities. That makes D to be the correct option. Next, this is the question that might take a lot of your time. This is the question that should take 10 minutes, 10 to 15 minutes, 10 to 15 minutes. But this is the question. If we do this question, I think we would justify our today's lecture. An amazing question, a really challenging one, by the way. Let's do this question. Madden Corporation's controller has gathered the following information. Do not get bogged down by the quantity or the size of the question. You will have to face such questions on the exam. Just not more, maybe 10 to 15 or 3 to 4. But there will be some challenging questions that will require some serious effort. So Madden Corporation's controller has gathered the following information as a basis for preparing the statement of cash flows. Net income for the year was $82,000. That's the starting point. During the year, an old equipment with the cost of $60,000, net book value of $53,000 was sold for cash at a gain of $10,000. All right, so we have sold an asset for certain amount, which has got us $10,000 gain on disposal. Net income is $82,000. New equipment was purchased for $100,000. Shown below are the selected closing balances of cash, receivables, inventories, equipment, accumulated depreciation, accounts payable, notes payable, common stock and retained earning. What we are required to do, we need to find out the cash flow from operating activities. Challenging question, tough, but nonetheless doable. Let's start the working. We will start from your net profit figure. Net profit figure is given here, $82,000. So you will write $82,000 right here. We have one single item that will take the most of the time. We need to find out the depreciation amount, which is hidden. That's where most of the effort would be made. All right. Starting first with constructing the T account for your assets. Here we have the asset title equipment. Gentlemen, I'm going to prepare an account on net book value basis. What is net book value? Net book value means the opening cost of the equipment less the opening accumulated depreciation. Let me first write down the full format. You just need to plug in the given numbers and you will find out the depreciation or any missing number. We have the opening balance on the debit side of your equipment account or whatever the asset, closing balance on the credit side. Any asset that has been disposed, it is shown on the credit side. And please remember, the disposal is reported at net book value. Disposal is to be reported at the net. Whatever asset you sold, you write the net book value of that disposed asset. Right. On the credit side, you will see the depreciation figure. This is the format of the net book value account. Any asset that you acquire will be shown as an addition on the debit side, right? If you just plug in the given numbers, you can find the missing one. We have the opening net book value, that is 360 less 70, that is 290. 360 less 70 is 290. So the opening balance of equipment, the net book value is 290. The closing is 400 less 83. 400 is the cost, 83 is the accumulated depreciation, that is 317. All right. Then we sold an asset that had an original cost of 60, but that had a carrying value of 53. That's the net book value. Net book value, carrying value, or net book value, 53. Remember, it has to be reported at net book value because our account is on net book value basis, $53,000. All right. We have made some additions as well, $100,000 worth of additions. Now what we are left with is a missing number for depreciation, which would have been very difficult to calculate without this working. So the total of the debit is 290 plus 100, that gives you 390. And now, from 390, deduct 53, deduct 317. What you get is $20,000. This $20,000 was the depreciation figure that we needed. This is what we needed. This $20,000 represents the depreciation. Now, we have two numbers, 82, net income. 20,000 is the depreciation for the period. So, we don't need this working anymore. So $82,000 represents your net profit. We have added $20,000 depreciation for the period. Again, we sold this asset at a gain of $10,000. I'm sure you know your working, you know the format. The gain on disposal is deducted. Loss on disposal is added. Gain on disposal is deducted. Now we have done the major items that we were supposed to do. Net income, depreciation, and the gain on disposal is deducted. Now we have to make some working capital adjustments one by one. Our account receivables have decreased over the period. So decrease in account receivables effectively represents a cash inflow. It was 43 last year, now it's 37. So this represents 6,000 inflow plus. Inventories have gone up from 93 to 105. Increase in inventory effectively is an outflow. It's an outflow, negative $12,000. Equipment and accumulated depreciation has already been taken care of. Now we have accounts payable. Accounts payable have fallen from 22 to 19. The decrease in account payable effectively represents an outflow. Decrease in account payable means you have paid them. So this is negative $3,000 If you add them all, you should get your answer. 82 net income, depreciation added back, gain on disposal deducted, decrease in account receivables added inflow, then 12 and then minus 3. That gives you 83. That is C. $83,000 is the net cash generated by operations. That makes C to be the correct option, and C it is. Next question, question 34. There are just two questions related to integrated reporting. It's a new topic. It hasn't been tested before 2020. It was introduced in 2020. So a leading manufacturer of electric vehicles has accumulated customers' driving interaction data. Customer driving interaction data through its unique pilot-driven or driver assist program. This data will be used to further develop more advanced autonomous features that the company plans to implement in the near future on its most popular model. What's the idea? In integrated reporting, we just do not report the numbers, balance sheet, income statement. We report some non-financial information which is normally not present in conventional financial reporting. We report on human capital. These are six capitals that we report on our integrated reporting: financial capital, manufactured capital, intellectual capital. When you say intellectual capital, that means your patents, copyright, some internal processes, some systems, human capital, competent workforce, social and relationship, your relationship with your bankers, your vendors, your customers, society at large. And finally, the natural resources, the natural capital, maybe your specific location, maybe some unique natural resource that is benefiting you. So these six capitals are to be reported, not just the financial statements. We need to disclose these six different types of capital. So which of these capital he is referring to? A leading manufacturer of electric vehicles has accumulated customer driving interaction data, data related to customer driven, just like Google is accumulating our data. So customer driving interaction data through its unique pilot driver assist program. That this data will help them to refine their autonomous driving system. Like Apple is working on autonomous driving, Google is working, Uber is working, Uber. This data will be used to further develop more advanced autonomous features that the company plans to implement in the near future on its most popular model. In integrated reporting, the system used to accumulate and analyze the driving data is best categorized as what? It is not a human capital, of course. Its processes, its research work, for example, your patents, copyrights, that's what you call intellectual capital. It is not natural capital, natural endowments, some natural resources. It's man-made resource built upon your own intellectual capabilities, the result of your own intellectual effort. So it's intellectual capital. It's not manufactured capital, not goods or machinery. So that makes B to be the correct option. Intellectual capital represents the intangibles critical to the organization. It includes resources such as patents, copyrights, intellectual property, and organizational systems that you're talking about. Right. Moving on to the next question. Which of the following statements regarding an integrated report is correct? It only contains financial information? No, not just financial. We just saw there are six types of different capitals that need to be reported. It only focuses on the creation of value over time? No, it focuses on the creation of value over the short term, mid term, and long term. Those of you who have read the theory, I'm sure you would be aware that the time horizon given is short term, mid term, and the long term, medium term, and the long term, not just the long term. This is incorrect as well. It should include material matters, both positive and negative. We just don't need to report only the good things about our organization. If there are certain negatives, related to these capitals or any other negative information that should be provided to the decision makers. Integrated reporting framework asks you to include such information. So it should include material matters, whether they are positive or negative, in order to assist the decision makers in making the right decisions. And you're right. So that makes C to be the correct option, apparently. Why not D? It must be included as a prominent and accessible part of another report. Those of you who have read the theory, integrated reporting can be made available two ways. Either it could be a single standalone statement, or it could be embedded in your conventional financial statements. So it's not that integrated reporter should be a part of another report. It could be a standalone single statement in its own right. So that's the reason D is not the right option as well. So you people must appreciate the fact that in order to grasp the fully fine details of every question, you should read every option. You should have a good reason for rejecting each option, and you should have a good reason for selecting the given option. So very essential. That will help you. If you do this way, maybe if you do 100 questions, reading every option effectively makes them 400. So C it was, as we discussed. Next, there's a question that requires some adjustments in financial statements. There can be four different situations where financial statements may need some adjustments. First is the change in accounting principle, movement from one GAAP principle to another, movement from LIFO to FIFO, one revenue recognition standard to another. So when such a change is made, in that case, the financial statements needs to be retrospectively adjusted. Means, if you have 2019 financial statements and you are giving a comparative for the current financial statement 2020, and in 2020 you have revised your policy to value inventory from LIFO to FIFO, or from FIFO to LIFO, or one revenue recognition principle to another, change in accounting standard, US GAAP requires you that you should restate your prior financial statements as if the basis of preparation are the same. For example, previously you applied LIFO to your inventory valuation. In 2020, you have switched to FIFO. GAAP requires that you must revise your 2019 financial statements on FIFO, even though they were originally prepared in LIFO. So you have to prepare and revise them under FIFO and then make them comparable. This helps making financial statement more consistent. Even though we used LIFO last year, but when you're giving a comparative 2020 and 2019, the basis should be same on both sides. Basis should be base. So this is called retrospective treatment. You have to revise your prior year financial statements to make them comparable. Next adjustment, change in accounting estimate. Maybe you have revised your estimation of bad debts. Last year you applied allowance for uncollectible account at the rate of 6%, but this year you have applied at the rate of 2%. Since this revision is of minor in nature, US GAAP requires these adjustments of change in estimates to be applied prospectively only in the current period and in the future. Prior year financial statements need not be revised. Fine. It means if there is change in accounting standard, it needs retrospective treatment. Both year financial statements need to be based on the same principles, same standards. If there is change in accounting estimate, it is applied prospectively, that is current year and the future periods. If there is change in accounting entity, like there was an organization with the name A Incorporated, it has been taken over by B Incorporated, and now A is the subsidiary and B is the parent. Change in accounting entity, A is now a subsidiary of B. Even though we will be consolidating results of A and B in 2020, standards require us that the prior year financial statements must be made comparable in such a way as if these two companies were together since the earliest reported period. They were together since 2019. A and B were together last year and they were parent subsidiary this year as well. So when the change in accounting entity, we will prepare financial statement this way as if they are the same. They were parent subsidiary this year and they were the parent subsidiary last year. Consolidated financial statements are prepared this way. And finally, if there is, so remember, change in accounting entity, it requires retrospective treatment. 2020 and 2019 should be prepared on the same basis. And lastly, accounting error. There can be two type of accounting error. Those errors that affect the current year and those that affect the prior year. If the error has been discovered and it only affects the current year, you will simply amend your current financial statements and that's all. If the error is discovered now and it is related to the last year, you will have to revise the prior year financial statements so as to rectify them for the current comparison with the current year financial statements. So if the accounting error has been discovered in the current period and relates to the current period only adjust them for the current period. If the error relates to the prior year, you need to revise the prior year financial statements to make them comparable. So we needed this information for the next question. It says, a change in an estimate for bad debts called the uncollectible accounts should be treated in what way? It is not an error. It is not to be treated retroactively. It is not an extraordinary item. Gentlemen, ladies, remember, there is no such allowance for treating any extraordinary item in the US GAAP as well as IFRS. No extraordinary item may be reported on the face of income statement. It was allowed about a couple of years ago. Extraordinary items were considered those items that were too distinct from the business operations and they were too disfrequent and they were not too frequently occurring. So it is no longer required. Extraordinary items are not allowed. No item can be reported as an extraordinary item in the income statement. So a change in estimate for the allowance for uncollectible accounts, it is treated as affecting only the periods of the change and in the future. So that makes D to be the correct option. Indeed, it is. A change in estimate of bad debt should be treated as affecting only the period of the change and onwards. Next, Finer Foods Incorporated, a chain of supermarkets specializing in gourmet food, has been using the average cost method to value the inventory. Average cost method was being used. During the current year, the company changed to the first in first off method of inventory valuation, change in inventory valuation. The president of the company reasoned that this change was appropriate since it would more closely match the flow of physical goods. So we have switched from average cost to first in first out. And this method is suitable for our organization because our nature of the work is something that requires treatment of inventory using first in first out. We have just discussed the change in inventory valuation method is basically the change in accounting principle. This change should be reported on the financial statement as what? Of course, we just discussed retroactive or retrospective adjustment requiring the prior year financial statements to be revised. So that makes B to be the correct option. We just discussed this issue a little while earlier. Next, Best Billiard Company owns 40% of the Supreme Tables Company stock at a historical cost of $300,000. Just a little extra gyan for no extra cost. Remember, if your holding is between 0 to 20%, it means you have a very little influence in the company where you hold this much investment. If your holding is more than 20% and less than 50%, it means you have significant influence. And if your holding is more than 50%, and less than 100% or up to 100%, It means you exercise control. So if your holding is between 0 to 20%, for that we have a fair value option or held for trading option. But if your holding is between 20 to 50%, we have a method, and I'm sure all of you would have read it in detail. It's called the equity method. If your holding is between 20 to 50% and you exercise significant influence, we treat such an investment as an equity investment. What we do in equity investment, for example, if I have made an investment in a company, 40%, and my investment has a historical value of $300,000. Let's say if the company makes certain profit, let's say $100,000, and company hasn't yet declared any dividend, nothing has yet been declared. Since I own 40% of this company, I will simply calculate 40% of this net income, which makes it 40,000, and I will consider it as my own income. Even nothing has yet been received. Basically, it's a non-cash income. We haven't yet received, but we have considered it as our income. We have considered it as our income. Likewise, if the company where we have made investment of 40%, if the company incurs a loss, if there is a loss, in that case, like for example, if the loss amount is $50,000, 40% of this loss, that is $20,000, this loss would be shown in my income statement as a loss in the equity-based investee. So the point to remember, equity-based investment means if you have made investment in a company between 20 to 50% and you have significant influence, you will have the option to select equity method. There is another option, fair value option. I'm sure you would have read the theory. So equity method means if you're holding investment above 20%, less than 50%, whatever your investee earns, 40% belongs to you. Whatever your investee loses as a loss for the period, 40% will be charged in your income statement, right? Now, the point is, let's say, take this example. If $300,000 was the initial value of the investment, if the company made a gain of $100,000 net income, 40% of this belongs to me. Now, the value of my investment, the account balance of this investment would be $300,000 original balance. $40,000 is the share of my profit, makes it $340,000. Now, what happens? The directors of the company where I have made the 40% investment, they sit and finally they declare a dividend of $20,000. They declare a dividend of $20,000. Now, since I am a 40% owner, out of this $20,000, 40% will come to me. That is $8,000. Now, when I will receive this $8,000, it is not an income anymore. It's not an income. I have already considered 40% of the net income as my income. When I receive dividend, I can't consider it as an income again. It will be double counting. Then how do we book in our accounting system? We will debit bank, of course. We can't refuse. The money is coming in our bank account. We debit the bank, and it is no longer your income. You will credit the investment in equity-based investee. So remember, gain is added, and if you receive any dividend, dividend is deducted from investment by crediting the investment. All right, so what you've got, the idea that whenever there's a gain, it is added to the investment account. If there's a loss, it's deducted. And if you receive any investment, dividend on your investment, dividend is deducted. So you apply the same principle in this question. Best billiard company owns 40% of Supreme Table company stock at a historical cost of $300,000. So that is the original value of your investment in the company where you hold 40% stock, and that company is the equity-based investee. You are investor and that company is investee. Supreme Table recently reported their earnings for the period, whatever that earning was. Best Billiards proportional share of Supreme Table's prior year net income was 10,000. Whatever was the income, our share of income, 40% of the income is 10,000, and this 10,000 has to be added in the investment account, making it 310. So it means whatever the income this company earned, Supreme Table, 40% of this would be added in our net income for the period. Now, Best Billiards also received 15,000 in dividends from Supreme Tables in the prior year. This dividend is the return on your investment. Receipt of dividend will not be an income anymore. It has to be shown as a deduction from the investment account. So the balance in your investment account would now be $295,000, representing the decrease of $5,000 over the period. Opening balance was $300,000 and now it's $295,000. So based on the information presented, the proper presentation of this investment would result in Best Billiards reporting a decrease in the book value of their investments in Supreme Table by $5,000. So that makes A to be the correct option, and A it is: original balance, proportional share of the profit, deduct the dividends, and this would be the closing value of the investment. Next, under the US GAAP, which of the following statements best describes the effects on the financial statements resulting from a change in accounting classification for a security from available for sale to held to maturity? Available for sale AFS to held to maturity means we are talking about this. So when an investment is reclassified from available for sale to held to maturity, how do we treat it? First of all, there will be some unrealized gain and loss that would be present in your other comprehensive income. Any amount present in other comprehensive income is not reversed, but they are amortized in the same way as we amortized our bond discount and bond premium. Amortization of bond discount, amortization of bond premium, it is not in your Part 1 syllabus. The point to remember is, sometimes we issue a bond for more than its face value, maybe at 115. This $15 is called the premium, bond premium. This $15 is diminished every year through premium amortization. It could work this way, that sometimes you may have to sell your bond at a discount of maybe, let's say, $90. A bond that at a face value of 100 has been sold at 90. There's a discount of $10. This $10 discount is amortized over the period of the bond, and the amount 90 goes up to 100. Likewise, 115 comes back to 100. So premium is amortized, discount is amortized. Likewise, any unrealized gain and loss on this AFS that is present in the other comprehensive income, it is amortized accordingly. If it is loss, this loss is released shoya in your income statement. If it's a gain, it is released to income statement over the life of the bond. So, point to remember is that if the AFS is converted to held to maturity, any gain or loss that is present in OCI, in our statement of comprehensive income, it is amortized. And now this investment is held to maturity. I'm sure all of you would have read the theory. Any investment in bond that has been designated as held to maturity, that investment, that bond is reported at amortized cost, whatever the market fluctuation, market going up, bond value going down, any unrealized gain and losses are not considered when investment is held to maturity. That's the point to remember. Now let's see what do we have in the option. Comprehensive income will be impacted in the future by unrealized gain and losses. No. If an investment has been reclassified as held to maturity, no gains or losses of unrealized nature can be reported in OCI. Finished. Once it has been reclassified as held to maturity, market fluctuations will not be considered unless they are permanent in nature. So it's not the right answer. Let's jump to C. The balance sheet will be impacted by the unrealized gains and losses. No unrealized gains and losses, no fluctuations in the price would be considered because the bonds have been booked at amortized cost. Market fluctuations will not be considered unless they are permanent in nature. No change will occur regarding the accounting treatment for unrealized gains and losses. There will be a change. There will be no more unrealized gains and losses. So it means the only option that is left, and it has to be correct, net income will not be impacted in the future by unrealized gains and losses. If the market value fluctuates, it will not influence the net income. So that makes B to be the correct option, and B it is. Ladies and gentlemen, please be careful. Do not just throw the text away and jump onto the next question. If you are practicing from whatever software, Wiley, Glime or Hawk, I recommend, if you are doing self-study, I recommend that you should read the description in detail of every option. Even it takes more time, but this is the best way of practicing. No teacher in the world can teach you this way, that you are doing yourself, you're teaching yourself. Read every option, convince yourself why the right is right, why the wrong is wrong. Read this text, which we conveniently throw away once you get the right option. Please, this is an important point to remember. Next. A company has 100 million of debt that is due in March year 3, right? In December year 2, the company entered into a non-cancelable agreement with its lender to refinance the debt with the same interest rate, and the full principal is due in December year 5. That is 2 years rescheduling. No interest is to be paid, no principal is to be paid for the next 2 years. Now, since it has happened before the balance sheet date, how would the debt be classified on the December year 2 balance sheet of the company? It is a very straightforward question, but let's make it complex. Let's play with the question. Let us play with the question. Since it has been decided before the balance sheet date, even the year was closed, it was refinanced through a non-cancelable agreement, it's a non-current liability. What if, let's twist the question a bit. Let's twist it a bit. Let's say that the loan was due on March year 3 to be paid. It's a current liability, no doubt. We were in negotiation with the banks, right? And finally, we reach an agreement on 15th of January. That is 15 days past the balance sheet date. On 15th of January, let's say now, this is not December year 3, 2. It is basically 15th of Jan. After the balance sheet date, the company entered into a non-cancelable agreement with its lender to refinance the debt with the same interest. Now, the situation has totally reversed. We have a valid evidence with us, but on 15th Jan that the loan has been refinanced. It has happened after the balance sheet date. The question is, balance sheet has not yet been approved for publication. What should we do? Is it an adjusting event or a non-adjusting event? The point to remember, since the negotiations were going on before the balance sheet date on 31st of December, events after the balance sheet date confirmed on 15th of January that such negotiations were taking place, and on 15th we have got a conclusive evidence that the negotiation has been finalized and the loan has been rescheduled. Even this event happened after the balance sheet date. Since the conditions were existing on the balance sheet date, even then, we will classify it as a long-term liability. Even it was not a long-term liability on 31st of December, because it was due in the month of March year 3. But since we have entered into the rescheduling agreement or non-cancelable agreement with the banker on 15th of Jan, 15 days after the balance sheet date, it's after the balance sheet date event, it's an adjusting event, because the conditions were existing before the balance sheet date, because the negotiations were being. So even then it will be considered as a long-term liability. But if we started our negotiations maybe on 7th of January, we started our negotiation with the bank on 7th, there was no indication before the balance sheet date. We initiated our negotiations with the bank on 7th January. Now, this is the event that has happened after the balance sheet. It is not adjusting anymore. That is just a complication you people don't need to know in that detail. But for the time being, since it was entered in an agreement before the balance sheet date, so it will be classified as a long-term liability. So that makes B to be the correct option. It would be given somewhere here. Next, for a corporation that is subject to the US Income Tax Code and reports its financial results in accordance with the US GAAP. Now, there are issues. We prepare our financial reporting under the US GAAP, whereas we may have to make certain adjustments for the tax code. So that is the case in most of the time, that your accounting income is different than your taxable income. This results in some temporary differences. I'm sure you would have read the topic, income taxes. So, which of the following requires the recognition of a deferred tax liability? Before we do this question, let us just have a look at this example. Let's say your income under the US GAAP is $100,000 and it is more than the taxable income that is calculated using the tax code in the US. Let's say, as per the tax code, your taxable income comes out to be $80,000, right? Now, your income is $100,000 as per your accounting system, your US GAAP, but the taxable income is $80,000. The point is that you will have to pay tax not on $100,000, you will have to pay tax on $80,000 because that's the taxable income. Tax is paid on taxable income. It doesn't mean that you will get away with tax that you may have to pay on this $100,000. You might be paying low tax now on $80,000, but the difference between these two incomes, you will be taxed in the future. This would result in a different deferred tax liability. You're not paying tax now on $100,000. The differential is $20,000. You are paying tax on $80,000, but in the future, you will have to pay because there are two absolutes in the world, death and taxes. So you can't run away from taxes. You will have to pay them sooner or later. So even you are paying less tax on this $80,000 taxable income now, but in the future, when some item of income which you have considered now, this item of income will be considered for tax purposes in the future, and you will have to pay tax in the more tax in the future, resulting in a deferred tax liability. Not deferred, it's a deferred tax liability. Conversely speaking, when your income under the US GAAP is less, but your taxable income is more, you will have to pay more tax now. Let's say at the average rate of 40%, you pay 40,000 tax now. But since some items of income which tax laws have considered incomes now, you will be considering incomes in the future. So in the future, you will be paying less tax. It will result in a deferred tax asset. So the point that you need to remember is when your accounting income is greater than taxable income, you won't be taxed now, rather you will be taxed in the future, resulting in the future tax liability, deferred tax liability in the future. Or when your taxable income is more than the accounting income, you may be paying tax, more tax now, but in the future you will be paying less tax, resultantly it will result in a deferred tax asset. That's the theory behind it. Now let's read the question here. And this is the question right here. For a corporation that subjects to the US Income Tax Code and reports its financial results in accordance with the US GAAP, which of the following requires the recognition of a deferred tax liability? Deferred tax liability arises when your accounting income is greater than your taxable income, and hence you get away with the low tax now, but you will be punished in the future in the form of higher taxes. So it will result in a deferred tax liability. Let us read these options one by one. Subscription received in advance and accounted for ratably over the subscription item. Subscription received in advance, it is considered as a taxable income as soon as you receive it. Tax laws will consider it as income as soon as you receive it. So your taxable income will be higher, and you will only consider this income once you earn it. Because once we receive money from our customers, it is not our income unless we earn it. But the tax laws are different. Tax laws say when you receive a subscription from your customers, income will be considered at the point of receipt. So taxable income is more than the accounting income in this case. So it would result in a deferred tax asset, not a liability. Wrong. B. An accrual of product warranty expenses, you have considered an expense now, resulting in you have reduced your accounting income. But for tax, they don't consider this expense as yet. Under the tax laws, warranty expense is not considered as an expense unless it has actually been paid. So you will have a higher taxable income than accounting income. So it means it will result more tax being paid now, less tax in the future, resulting in a deferred tax asset. Incorrect. We are looking for a deferred tax liability. C. Interest received on state and municipal bonds. Interest received on government, municipal or state bonds. They are exempt from tax. So they will result in permanent differences. They do not result in deferred tax asset liability. They are exempt incomes. Irrelevant. Incorrect. Now look at the last option. Option C. D. Sales accounted for on accrual basis. You have booked on sales which you haven't yet received. So your accounting income is more. But the tax people won't consider it income unless it is earned and received. So your accounting income is more based upon the accrual concept, whereas the taxable income is less. So you might be required to pay less tax now. It doesn't mean you will get away with it. You will have to pay more tax in the future, resulting in a deferred tax liability for the future. So that means D would be the right answer, and D it is. And as I said, please don't throw it away. This is more than any trainer. Read this up and you will get through the exam. But I can jump. 42. Which of the following transactions would affect the retained earnings but not additional paid in capital? I would like to spend some time on this question, because this question in itself teaches you so many things. First, the question says, which of the following transactions would affect retained earnings but not additional paid in capital? Declaration of small stock dividend. When a company issues stock dividend which is less than 25%, the entry that is passed in the journal is we debit, remember it's a stock dividend, we debit the retained earning . We credit the common stock and we credit the additional contributed capital. When the dividends issued are less than 25%, it's called a small stock dividend. The number of shares that you're issuing, you will take the market price that is prevalent, like let's say $40 the market price, $10 the par. We will debit our retained earning with the market value. Let's say 1,000 shares were issued to our shareholders, which were less than 25% of our existing shares. So 1,000 multiplied by 40, you will debit 40,000 retained earnings. Par value is 10. 10 times 1,000. 10,000 goes to the common stock, and the remaining 30,000 goes to the additional contributed capital, which you call the additional paid in capital as well. Right? But if you issue shares stock dividend that is greater than 25%, it is called the large stock dividend. Let's say you issued 2,000 shares as stock dividend, of course, which is quite high. In this case, you will simply debit retained earning with the par value, 2,000 times 10, that is $20,000, and you will credit the common stock with the par. No additional contributed capital is involved if there is a large stock. It's a fine point. It has been tested in an essay type question. So you debit your retained earning, you credit your common stock with the par if it's a large stock dividend. If it's a small stock dividend, you will debit your retained earning with what? With the market price of the shares that are being issued as stock dividend. Debit retained earning, credit common stock, credit additional contributed capital with the difference between the market price and the par value. So, what's the point? Declaration of small stock dividend affects retained earning and it affects additional contributed capital. What we are looking for, a transaction that affects retained earning, but it doesn't affect additional paid in capital. So, that rules out option A. Next, decrease in the value of an available for sale investment. When available for sale investment is decreased, it goes as a part of your other comprehensive income. Any fall in the market value of available for sale investment, it goes to the other comprehensive income. Right? And other comprehensive income is a part of equity. Right. So in this case, it is not affecting retained earning. We are looking for something which of the following transaction would affect retained earning, but not additional paid-in capital. So this transaction is not affecting retained earning. It is not affecting the additional paid-in capital. It is affecting the other comprehensive income. So none of these two. We are looking for a transaction that affects retained earning, but not additional paid-in capital. Here we go. Let's see the next one. So it is affecting none. It is affecting both. We are looking for something that is affecting retained earning, but not additional paid-in capital. Impairment of long-term assets. When long-term assets are impaired, it's a loss. This loss is reported as a part of net income. Your net income falls. Net income eventually is closed in a retained earning, so your retained earnings are impacted. But it has no effect on additional paid-in capital whatsoever. So it's a transaction, impairment of long-term assets. Their impairment will affect the retained earning, but it will not affect the additional paid-in capital. That's the right answer. But why not D? Purchase of treasury stock using the cost method. There are two methods to treat the treasury stock. One is called the cost method. Other is called the par method. When we use the cost method, you will simply debit, because these are the shares, your own shares that you buy from the market. So there are two ways. Either if you're the composition of your statement of changes in equity is that some amount is shown as common stock, some is shown in the retained earning, some is shown as the additional contributed capital, right? Now, when you buy your own stock, you credit the bank, of course you had to pay, and you debit your treasury stock with the cost. So crediting bank with $100,000 and debiting the treasury stock, this is called the cost method. Debit the treasury stock, credit the bank. It is neither affecting the retained earning nor affecting the additional contributed capital. Right? Debit the treasury stock, credit bank. Bank is, of course, offset against the bank balance. Treasury stock, it is reported as a contra equity. It is shown as a reduction from equity accounts. So it is not affecting retained earning, not affecting additional capital. What about par? How do we treat the treasury stock when it is treated at par? In that case, what you do, you split this $100,000 into two parts. One, some part of it will cancel the common stock, and some part of it, which you have paid more, will cancel some of your accumulated, or what you call the additional paid-in capital, additional contributed capital. If it is at cost, you simply debit treasury stock, credit bank, and show treasury stock as an unadjusted reduction from equity. But if you treat it at par, it means you have to break down your treasury stock amount into common stock and the additional contributed capital. The entry in that case would be, you debit your common stock, you debit your additional contributed capital, and you credit the bank. And that $100,000, which was originally debited as a treasury stock, now it will be split into its par and its additional value that you have to pay to acquire the asset. So it is affecting only additional paid-in capital, but not both. So that makes C to be the correct option, and C it is. Next question, 43. During the month of October, a company purchased 100 or 1,000 units of inventory at this price per unit and sold 900 of these units, which represented 10% of the company's annual sales budget in the units. We purchased these many units at this price, and out of these, 900 were sold, which that represented 10% of the budget. Fine. The company also incurred administrative cost of $300,000 during the month of October. By applying the matching principle, what is the matching principle? That current year expenses must be considered within the current period. Any accrual or prepayment has to be adjusted. Current year expenses must be matched with the current year revenues. Any expense or income that relates to the future period must be excluded. Right? So by applying the matching principle, the total amount of company's expenses, mind the term, expenses on its October income statement is, first of all, this $3,000 administrative expense, it is an expense. Without doubt, it will be considered as an expense. An item of inventory is our asset, no doubt. It would be an asset as long as it is in your mustawdar, it's in your warehouse. As soon as it is sold, it becomes cost. An item of inventory, the item that you trade in, is your asset as long as it is in your warehouse. The moment it is sold, sale is recognized, the value of that inventory becomes cost of sales. So we bought 100 to 1000 units, fine, but out of these, 900 units have been sold. Since they have been sold, the cost related to these units would represent the cost of sales, which effectively is the cost. So that will be 900,000 multiplied by 500, that is 450. So 450 is basically your cost of sales, which is an expense for the period, and $300,000 represents the administrative expense. So the total of expenses would be 750. So that makes A to be the correct option. So applying the matching principle, the expense for the period would be A, and A it is. Next, a consulting company won a 20.8 million 3 years contract, construction contract. The contract requires software development, soft hosting, web hosting, and maintenance over the 3 years period. The total estimated cost of the project is $17 million. This is the cost, estimated cost, with 10 million expected in the year one spending, 5 million is expected in year two, and 2 million in the year three. So this is the expected cost. This is the agreed selling price, right? The billing schedule shows that 5 million will be billed upon the start of the work, then 5 million at the end of each year. That's the billing schedule, 5 million, 5 million, 5 million. All right, and at the end of the first year, the actual cost incurred is 9 million and the total estimated costs are unchanged at 17 million. Using the percentage of completion method, how much revenue should be recognized at the end of the first year? Now, what do we have? Let us analyze the information again. We have the contract price that is given as 20.8 million. We have the estimated cost 17 million that stays the same till the end of the contract, or at least the end of the first year. Using the percentage of completion method, how much revenue, not profit, mind the word, revenue, how much revenue should be recognized at the end of the first year? How much revenue would you recognize depends upon the level of completion, the stage of completion. We have to first determine the stage of completion. For that, we will have to first see how much cost have we incurred. How do we determine the level of completion, the percentage of completion? We simply check how much cost we have incurred to date, cost incurred. Remember, this is the formula, cost incurred divided by total estimated cost. This will give you the work done so far. Since it's the first year, no revenue has yet been recognized. The cost incurred so far is 9 million. The total estimated cost stays the same as it was originally, 17 million. It will give us the percentage of completion that we have done work so far. 9 by 17, that is 52.94%. Gentlemen, remember, we are not required to calculate the profit for the period, the revenue. Since the contract price was 20.8 million and it's the first year, no profit or revenue has yet been recognized ever. It's the first time you're doing it. So what we will do, 20.8 billion is the total revenue and we have earned 52.94% out of it. So you will take 20.8 million, the total price, times 52.94%. That is 11.01 million. This is the recognized revenue. That makes A to be the correct option. Let us twist the question a bit. Let's say, if the question says, how much profit, not revenue, how much profit should be recognized in the year one? So our level of completion was 52.94. The overall contract revenue appears to be 20.8 was the revenue. and 17 was the total estimated cost. The difference between these two represents the overall profit on the contract. That's 20.8 million. 20.8 less 17, it's 3.8 million. That is the overall profit on the contract. And out of this total profit, I have earned 52.94%. If the profit was required, how much profit would be recognized at the end of the first year? You will calculate the difference between the revenue and the estimated cost. That will show the total profit, out of which 52.94 has been earned, and that would be your answer in that case. So since it is not needed, we just have to find out the revenue earned. So that's 11 million. So that makes A to B the correct option. Moving on. At the beginning of the year, a company entered into a long-term contract to build a facility for 40 million. That's the contract price, construction contract. Half of the construction would be completed each year for the next 2 years. It means the project would be completed within 2 years. At the beginning of the following year, other than this contract, the company received a second contract to construct a second facility for $80 million. This is a separate contract than the first one. Now, this project will last 4 years. 30% would be done in year one, 25% in year two, year three, and year four. Do not confuse. The first contract was for 2 years. The second contract, almost double, will last 4 years. Right? If the company recognized revenue of $40 million in the second year, the method it is used to account for the long-term construction contract. Now, $40 million was the contract price for the first project. Right? If the company recognized revenue of $40 million in the second year, the method it used to account for long-term construction contract was. Now, the first contract with the value $40 million was expected to be completed in second year. We consider the whole of this amount only at the end of the second year. Right? Otherwise, if you calculate the percentages, it would be like the second contract is worth $80 million. The first contract was $40 million, right? Year one, year two. This $40 million, half of it was earned in year one, $20 million. Half of it was earned in year two, $20 million. The second contract given in blue color, that was also earned where? At the beginning of the following year, next year. This project is worth $80 million. There was no earning from this project in year one because we received this contract in year two. So in year two, the revenue should be 30% of 80 million. That is 24 million. So gentlemen, if this company had used the percentage of completion, we should have expected a total revenue of 44 million, but that is not so. Which means it is not using percentage of completion because this number should have been the revenue using percentage of completion. Then what could it be? If you just look carefully, the first contract that has been completed in year two was 40 million, and we considered 40 million as our revenue in the second year, meaning thereby this company is using the completed contract method. No revenue is recognized until the project is complete. This method, called the completed contract method, it is only allowed under the IFRS, US GAAP. It is only allowed under the US GAAP, IFRS, sorry. It is only allowed under the US GAAP. IFRS does not allow completed contract method. So we can be sure now, if the company has recognized the full revenue in the second year from the first contract, the method it is used to count for the long-term construction contract was the completed contract method under the US GAAP. IFRS does not allow Option B. IFRS does not allow the completed contract method. So that's the answer. Next. A company is preparing its financial statements in accordance with the US GAAP. Listed below are select financial data for the company. What we are required to do? What is the amount that would be reported as comprehensive income? What is comprehensive income? Here it is. Statement of comprehensive income statement of comprehensive income called the SCI. It has two components. The first component all of you are familiar with, it's called the income statement. The second component or the second segment is called the other comprehensive income. More appropriately, if I can give it in an equation form, that will make more sense. Comprehensive income has two parts. One is the conventional income statement, which you have been preparing, called the profit and loss account. The other part is called the other comprehensive income, and it has unique four transactions that are so distinct. And there are gains and losses in these transactions, but these gains and losses are not reported on the income statement. Rather, they are reported on the other comprehensive income. So basically, comprehensive income is the sum of income statement and other comprehensive income, right? So that's the point here. This is your net income, the first part of your comprehensive income, and this is the second part, other comprehensive income. I told you there are four elements to it, other comprehensive income, and these elements are so distinct that any gain and losses on these transactions are not reported as a part of income statement. What these four items are: loss on defined benefit post-retirement plans. Pension was a part of your CMA syllabus before 2010. It was a part of your syllabus in 2015, but within 2015, pensions was excluded. So pensions are no longer part of your syllabus from 2015 December. So loss or gain on defined benefit post-retirement plans, any gain and loss, it's reported as other comprehensive income. Any foreign currency translation, mind the word, not transaction. Translation gain and loss, it's a part of other comprehensive income. Any gain or loss on available for sale securities remeasurement, it's a part of OCI. And any portion of cash flow hedge, hedging you will study in your part 2 in corporate finance section B, CMA part 2. Effective portion of cash flow hedges, these are four different transactions, so distinct that they are not a part of your regular income statement. They are reported separately as a part of OCI. This OCI and net income, which is income statement, collectively is called comprehensive income. Now, back to the question. What is the amount that would be reported as comprehensive income? When you say comprehensive income, mean it's the sum of income statement plus the elements of other comprehensive income. So net income, yes, is from income statement. Depreciation will not be considered. This has been just given to confuse you people, and you people get easily confused. That's why you keep on failing again and again. Depreciation has already been accounted for while determining the net income. Right. Investment by owners is the part of your equity. It's the part of equity, statement of changes in equity. It is not a part of other comprehensive income. Other comprehensive income contains just those four transactions: gains and losses on foreign currency translation, pension adjustments, effective portion of cash flow hedge, and any gain and loss on remeasurement of available for sale securities. These four items distinctively. So this is not to be reported here. Investment by owners is a part of equity. Unrealized gain on available for sale, yes. Since it's a gain, it must be added. So what we have so far, we have net income, investment by owner, ignore, unrealized gain on available for sale securities to be added, and foreign currency translation loss to be deducted. Just three items, and you will get the balance of your comprehensive income. So it's 950. Plus 90, less 20, it gives you 1020. That makes B to be the correct option, and B, it should be, and B it is. Next, last question from your CMA Part 1, Section A. A fundamental difference between the US GAAP and the IFRS is that reversal of inventory write-downs is permitted in IFRS. Yes, inventory write-down can be reversed in the later period, but reversal should not be more than the previous write-off. Yes, inventory write-off can be reversed in IFRS. However, reversal of inventory write-down is not allowed under US GAAP. It's a correct statement. IFRS allows inventory write-off can be reversed, but under the US GAAP, inventory once written down under the LCM method or under the cost versus NRV, whichever is lower. I'm sure you know the methods. Just a quick review. You people should know this if there is a little ambiguity. In the US GAAP, we have two rules for inventory valuation. One is called the LCM rule. Other is called the lower of cost or NRV, whichever is lower, cost versus NRV. Whereas in the IFRS, we have just one principle, cost versus NRV, whichever is lower. Right. Cost versus NRV is applied on all types of inventory except LIFO and retail method. LIFO and retail method of inventory valuation. Only for these we apply LCM rule. And what is LCM rule? As a CMA student, you should know that. And if you don't know that, it means you haven't read well. And for the rest of all inventory, we use cost versus NRV. That is the same as IFRS. It means that as far as inventory valuation is concerned, GAAP and IFRS are same. Only for LIFO and retail method, for which in the US GAAP we use LCM rule, right? And the important difference here is that in the US GAAP, if the inventory has been written down, maybe either under LCM rule or cost versus NRV, the reversal is not allowed. Whereas in IFRS, where we use only cost versus NRV, any inventory write-down can be subsequently reversed, but the reversal shouldn't be more than the previous write-off. So that is the correct statement. That's the fundamental difference between IFRS. And that makes it to be the correct option. A, it is. Rest of the terms, options are just ridiculous. Now your Section A MCQs are over, and I couldn't find any essay type from Section A in all the 30 essays that are included as a part of your CMA exam support package. So I have just drawn up some essay type from myself to let you know how you attempt the essay type on the exam. Let's say this is the essay type. The information is given in front of you. The Horatio company's beginning and ending inventory for the fiscal year ended September 30th, year 2 are given below. You have the opening, work in process, finished goods and material, and closing. You have been given the material purchased, discounts on purchases, direct labor, and manufacturing overhead. Just a simple example. Now calculate the cost of goods manufactured for the period ended September 30th, year 2. Cost of goods manufactured. You can use these abbreviations in your responses. Do not write cost of goods manufactured is equal to beginning work in process plus materials. You are very short on time. You can use these abbreviations and they are good because the examiner is also a CMA. He knows what these terms mean. So do not go for the detailed write-offs. So you'll simply write the cost of goods manufactured, and what you need to plug in, you don't need to draw up any table or column arrangement. Simply give your results or your responses in a paragraph form. You write this formula and you simply lay down all your calculations within a paragraph. How would you go? Like cost of goods manufactured, I will write just an equal sign again. Beginning work in process, 30,000 was the raw material. It will come here. Beginning work in process is 80,000. Direct labor, 200,000. Manufacturing overhead, 150. All in paragraph form. Ending work in process, 70,000. Now, for this is a little effort is needed in determining the raw material consumed. I'm sure you know that. Raw material used up. Material used is equal to opening stock of raw material plus purchases minus any discounts or returns and minus closing stock of raw material. So we have the opening stock of raw material as 30. Purchases, that was 160. Discount, 2000. That is a part of your rough working. And closing stock is 44. So we have just jotted it down on the scratch paper that is given to us on the exam. I've just written it down. You just have to write all the stuff down here that was included as a part of your rough working. So you just wrote COGM, cost of goods manufactured, beginning work in process, This you couldn't write here. You just made the rough working somewhere else and you simply typed it in. Plus direct labor, plus manufacturing overhead, minus ending, and tuck, that's the answer. And finished. Do not go any further. You people would be very short on time. You have to be on the spot. Save as much time as you can. Use abbreviations. Give bullet points. And you're good to go. That is not suggested for ACC exams, of course. My background is from ACC, CA. We are not required to give bullets and short them. We are required to give detailed responses. We are not allowed to use bullets on our ACC exams or CA. But in CMA exams, gentlemen, ladies, you can use bullets. You can give the points 1, 2, 3. You can bullets and these numbers you can give to, you can use these to give your responses. Perfectly fine. And now you got your solution. Do not go for any tabulation. Next. Calculate the cost of goods sold for the period ended September 30th, year 2. Cost of goods sold. So for cost of goods sold, it's CGS basically. CGS. What you need is the finished goods opening stock. It's given as 16,000. Cost of goods manufactured that you have previously calculated. Let's say it's 180, whatever. And minus finished goods closing. Finish. You got your cost of goods sold. As simple as that. Don't go for any tabulation or formatting. You won't get any marks for formatting. Just give your responses in a paragraphic form. Show your computations within a paragraph. For rough workings, use the scratch paper, put the workings there, and simply copy paste the working from the scratch paper onto your computer screen. You're good to go. Calculate the value of inventory as on September 30th, year 2. When he says the word inventory, he may mean materials, work in process, and finished goods. Do not make columns. You can simply write the value of inventories. Value of inventories is equal to material, MAT, plus work in process, plus finished goods. You can write this way, perfectly fine. And in the same line, horizontally, in a paragraphic form, write down the material, that is 44,000, work in process, 70, and finished goods, 24, and give the total, and that's, and say, Masalama, and go home. Don't go for detailed formatting. Give what is needed. Do not overdo the things. You will be facing, inevitably, you will be facing shortage of time. So try to be as specific as possible. Try to focus on giving whatever is needed. Overdoing will only put you in trouble and your time management will be totally destroyed. So I think that's all, ladies and gentlemen. Section A is over.